Putin fans, I've been a Giants fan for 15 years, and they came through like I always thought they did. Giants is number one!
Nice, Lynn. Thank you. A wedding with a small group of friends. Well, let's now go from jubilation to the reasons behind it. Here's John Dockery at the Sports Extra Desk with highlights of the game and some behind-the-scenes analysis of the Giants' giant-size win. John?
Thank you, Barbara. It's certainly time to celebrate. The Giants are indeed Super Bowl champions. They beat the Broncos 39-20. You know, Denver had some early chances, but the big blue machine opened up in the second half to bury the boys from Denver. Phil Simms, a sparkling performance. Here he hits Zeke Moat. Giants led 7-3 first quarter. Now a brilliant call by Denver. John Elway, watch him here. Quarterback draw, takes it into the end zone. Denver ahead 10-7. Second quarter, Giants defense came on strong. George Martin with a big rush on Elway. From the outside, watch the left side of your screen. Takes Elway down in the end zone for a sack. Giants trail 10-9 at the half. Third quarter, Simms, outstanding, most valuable player in the game, hit Mark Bavaro, 13-yard touchdown, Giants 16-10 edge. Fourth quarter, it was all Phil Simms, folks. He's looking for Bavaro again. It bounces off Bavaro. Watch it right here. McConkie in the end zone, touchdown. The Giants go on to win it 39-20. They are a Super Bowl champions of Super Bowl 21. And Bill Parcells and the Giants are indeed the best team in football, Barbara. They have a right to celebrate and to break out the champagne.
I'll go to the Rose Bowl, where your partner Bill Mazur is standing by, a very happy man with some lucky guests. Bill.
Thank you very much. The Giants may be celebrating in the locker room, but the wives are celebrating, and the girlfriends are celebrating here. This is Colleen Burt, Jimmy Burt's wife. This is the most valuable player in the entire thing, Diane Simms, and this is Annette DiNapoli, whose boyfriend Leonard Marshall really started it. Dion, listen, it's been a long day. First, let's talk to the MVP's wife. Nervous at the beginning?
Very nervous at the beginning because I thought they weren't getting it together yet, and they really needed to get all the crinks and cranks out of them. I think they were nervous.
It's funny, Colleen Burt. Tell the folks what you told me before the game about Jimmy.
That he was nervous?
Yeah.
Yeah, he was really nervous, and he didn't want to talk to anyone. I called, and I just said, good luck, and he said, okay, I can't talk. He was all choked up.
Yeah.
They were pumped up.
Did you see the dance he's now doing?
Yes.
He's got a Baryshnikov thing. Now, were you at all surprised? Well, you had to be, by the way, Phil played today.
Oh,
it was unbelievable.
I never saw it. It's always defense. And it was really just hanging on his back after a while that he had to complete passes because there was no running game for a while.
No, there wasn't.
You know, it was very slow.
I thought the defense didn't come through at the beginning, Mr.
Well,
Napoli.
What was that?
I said I thought the defense was a little slow.
I thought so, too. But as usual, they come through all the time. And I'm really proud of Leonard. He had a great game. The whole defense had a great game.
Great. Listen, we're going to be back a little later on Sports Extra. Colleen Burt, Mr. Napoli, and of course, Phil Simms' wife, Diane. You got a shot of his little boy? Come here. Come here. Let me just get a shot of the Burt kid. And this is Christopher Simms. And there, who does this look like? Are you kidding? That's the face of Burt. Back to you in the studio.
Okay, thanks, Bill. Still to come, the explosion that leveled a bowling alley on. Okay, Bill, as promised, and now some important news stories.
Girl, it's been a whole hard season on us this year, but we've done everything we wanted to do. Accumulated it, and we worked very hard, and we get the penalty. We did it all today, Carl. I can't even talk. I'm so happy.
What about the play of your quarterback?
I think our quarterback showed today that there's other quarterbacks in the world outside of John Elway. Phil Simms showed that he's a great quarterback, and given the opportunity, he shined today.
Did the Denver defense surprise you guys the way that they played, or was it just the Giants not playing that well in the first half?
I think that we just didn't play well in the first half, Carl. I think that we've made some good second-half adjustments. Today, we just came out in the second half and did the things we did best.
Okay, I know you want to go, Joe. I really appreciate the time you've given us. I know you're not giving a lot of these interviews.
Thank you very much, Carl.
Right, congratulations. All right, let's go back to Barb in New York, live from the New York Giants locker room. Why don't you get a shot of this locker room? Carl White, Channel 5 Sports.
Thanks, Carl. We'll try a little later on. More from Pasadena later, too. But the second biggest...
We are the New York Giants. We don't fool around. The other teams are trembling when we come to town. Giant man is quite a man. Women and children too. If you back another team, something's wrong with you. We are the New York Giants. Don't you know we're great? Football is our business. That's what you know. We can't wait. We are the New York Giants. Don't you know we're great? Football is our business.
Never lose because they march it on the field in giant shoes.
To the end of time for all eyes to see. Plus written in the books of history for the people to read when they grow old.
That's the Giants won the 21st Super Bowl. It was a real tough season, but they played hard. Fought for every point, earned every yard. They gave blood, sweat, and tears.
Right now, they're on Mazer right now. They're coming to you next.
Well, they're just...
Kimber Jr., I got to tell you, he's only 5 years old. He's almost as big as I am. Notice, about 6 feet two. This family has been great. Byron, stay right there. I want to talk to you, too. But this is Jim Burt's son, Jimmy, his wife, Colleen, and his mother-in-law from Buffalo, Mrs. Kemp. Not Kemp, Kemp. Did you like the game? He certainly did, folks. He thinks it's an apple. Colleen... We didn't have that much of a chance to talk before, but tell me what your reaction was from the time you came here.
When I came, the game started, and during the first quarter, I was getting really nervous. The defense didn't look as together as they always do. But when the second half came, and we were back to our old defense, I was real happy.
You sent a message to Jim during halftime.
Yes, I told him,
player,
come on,
no
get
food.
It, yes.
Thank you again,
Thank
Colleen.
You, Bill.
You've been great all week long. Thanks very much. Goodbye,
Bye-bye.
Jimmy. Jimmy, you want to bite the apple? There he goes.
Bye,
Colleen,
Bill.
You're a doll. Thanks very much.
Bye-bye.
Goodbye, Mrs. Kemp.
Bye-bye. Thank you very
now,
much.
Now, let me, Byron, come over here. Here's a young man who I thought had a great deal to do, believe it or not, because he didn't start, but that kickoff team had a little trouble at the beginning, and then you made a hell of a tackle coming down. What a win.
I'll tell you what, it really does feel good. We knew that we could change things if we went out and played well on special teams, which we had to do. I mean, they had a couple of long returns. But when we go out and we play aggressive, then there's nobody else that can play with us.
Byron, did Bill Belichick change anything in the scheme for the second half?
No, not at all. I mean, we had worked on the same things the entire week. We just didn't execute them very well. I mean, John Elway scrambled and he hit some deep passes across the field and a couple of them on the sideline over there. But we just knew that whenever he scrambled, we had to go back and get those receivers that were running wide open. We didn't do that the first half. We did that very well the second half, and that was the difference.
I thought in the, hello, I yelled a little. I thought that in the first half, they took more advantage of Lawrence than any other team has except San Francisco. They kept swinging the ball out to the side Lawrence was on. Adjustment made?
No real adjustments. I mean, they did the same things the first time we played them. And the thing is, we just didn't execute them very well. We didn't recognize a lot of things very well. And I think they try to take us a little bit out of our game plan because, as you know, Denver does a lot of things. They move a lot of people around. They try to trick you and confuse you. And we just didn't play that good, sound, solid defense the first half
but
that we needed to.
But you finally did.
That's right.
Congratulations,
Thank you very
big
much.
Fella.
Thank
I
you.
Mean, he is a big guy, 6'6". Let's go to a smaller man, Carl White, in the locker room.
Thank you.
We are here live in the New York Giants locker room, and I'm here now with Lionel Manuel. Lionel, I saw you doing this earlier, man. You were playing with that ring finger. How's it feel to know that you're going to be fitted shortly?
It feels good. Something I've been dreaming about and something we've accomplished finally, and it feels great.
Talk about the fact that the Giants came into this game very, very confident, very cool. You guys never let it go to your head. And even though it's the Super Bowl, it was still just another day at the office, although the first half, things got off to a slow start.
Yeah, I think it was important for us to keep a perspective, you know, within our own minds and You know, everyone expected us to win by so many points, so we never really listened to that. We just felt it was important for us to go out there and do what we were expecting, what our coach expected us to do, and that's exactly what we did.
How'd you feel about your play today? A couple of great catches and big ones at that.
That was great. I was just happy to be out there, just to be out there and see everyone.
Comments on the play of your quarterback, Phil Sims. Have you ever seen him better?
Great quarterback. I guess you can look at it, this is his Pro Bowl game since he didn't make it this year, and just as well as Carl Banks. Today was their Pro Bowl game, in a sense. So, he's a great quarterback.
What are you going to do during the offseason?
Rest. A lot of rest.
Kick back and enjoy it, huh?
That's it.
Congratulations, man. Appreciate you stopping by.
Thank you.
All right, let's go back to the studio now. John Dockery there.
John Dockery, I told you that the Giants would win by a margin somewhere between what they beat Washington by and what they beat San Francisco by. And I would have been exactly on the nose except, you know, garbage time at the end. What'd you think of the ballgame, Jono?
Phil, let me tell you what I thought. I agreed with you in that situation. I thought that the Giants would win handily, and certainly they did, although there were some scares in the first half. Of course, they were trailing 10-9 at halftime. And actually, John Elway did some things that they were afraid of in the first half, namely scramble around. Before you meet my guest in the studio, Terry Hanratty, who's been to a few Super Bowls, I want you to take a look at what happened today. Here are the highlights, folks. It's the Rose Bowl, 102,000 fans, Super Bowl 21. First quarter, first play of the game, Denver. John Elway did what he does best. He scrambled for a first down as LT rushed to the outside. That's what the Giants feared most. Denver scored on their first two possessions. Watch third and long here. Elway to Mark Jackson for the first down. That led to a Carlos field goal. Denver led 3-0. But the Giants and Phil Sims came out firing also. First play, a completion to Manuel. Sims confident. Then Sims found Zeke Moat in the end zone. Watch him here. Touchdown. Giants led 7-3 first quarter. The Giants defense got overly aggressive on this play. Watch Carson. Right there with the foul. LT with another. That gave Denver the ball on the 6-yard line. Then a brilliant call by Denver. A quarterback draw. Elway into the end zone. Denver on top, 10-7. Now an extremely controversial call. Did Clarence Kay catch this pass? The official said no. To me, it looked like he did. And it was a very, very important play because it took a first down away from Elway and the Broncos. And on the very next play, watch George Martin. The rush from the outside takes Elway down for a safety in the end zone. Giants trailed 10-9 as Rich Carlos missed two field goals in the first half, including this one right before the half. Now the third quarter. A gutsy call by Bill Parcells. It's fourth down. He's in his own territory. The Giants line up in punt formation, but no, they shift. Rutledge goes up under the center and then sneaks it for the first down. The drive was kept alive, and Sims later found Mark Bavaro, watch him here, for a touchdown, and the Giants took a 16-10 lead. The Giants added a field goal to make it 19-10, then some razzle-dazzle, watch it. Morris pitches back to Sims. He finds McConkey wide open. McConkey dives, hoping for the end zone, but he doesn't get in. No matter, folks, because on the very next play, Joe Morris followed Chris Godfrey around the right side for the touchdown. Giants led 26-10. They went on to beat Denver 39-20 in Super Bowl 21. And yes, Harry Carson was there, and he did get Bill Parcells. Break out the champagne. The Giants are the best team in professional football. Yes, they are the best team in professional football. And right now, Carl White is out in Pasadena with the best linebacker in professional football. Carl, are you there?
That's right, the best linebacker in professional football. Really not a bad guy. Lawrence Taylor, how you feeling, man? You guys did it on top of the world, huh?
Well, we're feeling great. You know, it's been a long time coming, and we're just happy right now. But I guess tomorrow it'll hit us that we are the best in the world.
How'd you feel about the play of Denver tonight in the first half? Did that surprise you at all, the way they were able to shut down the linebackers?
Well, they played very well the first half. You know, John Elway, you know, he would go back and he'd run, pass, and we kind of really expected that, but it shocked us a little bit, and the heat was tremendous out here. The second half, we put it all together. We said, let's go out here and do some work, and the health of the finesse game, we started playing off brand of football, which is physical football, and we was able to win with it.
What did Bill Belichick do at halftime, and what did Coach Parcells have to say to you guys at halftime?
Well, Bill and Bill and Bill. Both Bills really didn't have a lot to say because they knew, hey, they had played the best ball they had could play. We hadn't played that well, and we was only 1 point down. And it was up for us to really to go out there and do what we've learned. They weren't doing anything new. They weren't doing anything different. But we weren't playing the type of football that we know how to play. And the second half, it cooled off and tremendously, and it felt more like New York, and we felt at home, and we went out and played.
Going into the start of the second half, what was the attitude of the players? Were you guys kind of angry at yourselves, like, hey, man, this isn't right?
A lot of guys were down on themselves, and Bill Parsons said, listen, we've been a team all year now. It's not the time to fall apart. Let's stay as a team. And a lot of things were said that on first half, and we apologized for them. And we went out there and played ball. And I tell you, after the first drive of the second half and the first defensive stand, second half is like, hey, it's our game. We know what we're doing. Let's go play ball.
Give me a word or phrase to summarize the entire season and how Lawrence Taylor feels right now.
I guess the only word I can say is it's been a great season. And I feel great.
What are you going to do tonight?
I'm gonna drink a little bit, you know, I don't know.
I knew I could get it out of him. Thanks a lot, Lawrence. Let's go back to John Dockery standing by in New York.
He has a lot to celebrate. And when we come back, we're going to have more on the Giants. We're going to go back to Bill and Carl in Pasadena. And also going to talk to my guest, Terry Hanratty, former Notre Dame star and Pittsburgh Steelers quarterback. Of course, he was in two Super Bowls, Super Bowl 9 and 10. We'll have more in a moment, folks. Stay with us.
Take us through the ball game from the beginning.
Well, we were very fortunate in the first half to only be down 10-9. They hit some big plays on us, and that's not our defense. Our defense is let them have the short passes and come up and make the play on them, but they were able to hit some 40-plus yards three or four times on us, and they really put us in a hole. But we were very fortunate, 10-9, went in at halftime, and we said, hey, play to our potential in the second half, and we'll have a heck of a chance in the second half. And that's what we did, and it was downhill from there.
Belichick yell at you?
Bill, he's not that type of guy. He keeps things under pretty cool, and he had a great game plan for us. We knew exactly what to do. We just didn't execute in the first half, and the second half we knew it was crucial for us to come out and stop in the first couple series, and that was a difference in the game. We were able to stop their momentum and just play giant defense.
How tough were they compared to Washington? Who is this massive monster?
Eric Dorsey. What a monster.
Jimmy, how much bigger is he than you?
He is a mountain of a man. Look at him. Look at him back there.
How much do you weigh, Eric?
285. I'm light 285.
He's a light 285. Let me just finish
his own. He hurts his own players, by the way.
Who, Eric?
He's got to learn not to run.
Mean, nasty. Tell me about this. What changes did you have to make in the second half? Obviously, you didn't at all?
We didn't make any changes. We had a game plan. When John Owen has a tendency, when he breaks the pocket, he likes to throw deep. And what we did in the second half, we didn't stay in our deep zones, and we came up and came away from the receivers, and they were able to hit the big play. Well, when he broke the, we didn't allow him to break the pocket as much, but when he did, the defensive back stayed back. We chased him, made the play on him, and that was the difference in the game.
I'm going to let you in on a secret. At halftime, I saw Buddy Ryan. You know what he said to me? What
did he say?
Second half, the Giants are going to kick butts. He didn't say butts.
All right, Buddy Ryan.
That's exactly
hey,
what
I've
he
always
said.
Liked
he said
Buddy.
He thought you were a little soft on him in the first half. He says, second half, they're going to kick butts.
Hey, I appreciate that from Buddy Ryan because he's a great coach. And
what kind of a feeling?
I tell you, it's been something. 6 years, you waited for a long time for this, and we had some tough years, and we're the world champions. The New York Mets did it. The Giants did it. And we're going to have a hell of a celebration.
All right, what we're going to do is we're going to go back to Carl White, then we'll come back with Eric Dorsey. Jimmy?
I'll see you.
Thanks a million, okay, baby. Okay.
I tell you what, we're having a good time. You caught us. All right, no big deal. I'm here with Andy Hedden and Elvis Patterson. And as you can see, we're in the locker room, and these guys are very, very happy about the Super Bowl win. First, I want to ask Andy,
right?
How does it feel, big guy?
Oh, man, it feels like... I want to say the words, but hell, you know. But.
Be careful. We're live. Be careful. My job is on the line now.
Oh, man. I just want to, hey, it feels great, man. There's no words. I can't explain it. You just got to be here. Sorry you can't be here. Next year, I'll send everybody a ticket. Just ask me, all right?
Okay. What took so long for the real Giants to show up?
I think that the guys didn't really expect what it was going to be. Like, you know, we heard about we was overconfident. Hell, man, we just whooped the hell out of them, man. You know, it was nothing, man. We just, like, figured them out and went back second half and got to act together and went out there and kicked the tails.
Now, Elvis, you have to admit, John Elway did cause you guys some problems in the first half.
Well, you know, definitely. You know, Elway, you know, he's a quarterback in his own way and in his own dimension. There's not enough you can say about the guy. But, you know, at the beginning of the first half, and thing, you know, he threw a couple of balls up there for grabs and receivers. They was going back, and they just come back, and they made a couple of big catches, but they didn't get the ball in for 6 points. And that was the main thing. That's been our theme all year long. Give them 50, you can give them 25, 10. Just don't give them the 6 points.
When did you guys feel like you had the game wrapped up? When was it?
Well, you know, basically when we got that safety and when we came in here and the score was 9-10, and we all got together and we said, hey, we ain't out of this game now. Let's go out there and play our football because they're going to play theirs. And they gave us their best shot, and they didn't get the points that they wanted in order to win this game. So we just came out, and we dominated that second half, and we did the things that we've been doing throughout this whole season in order to win this game.
How does it really feel to win a championship, the Super Bowl? I was with the Mets a couple of months ago, and they were ecstatic. How do you guys feel?
Well, you know, I feel fabulous. I feel it's just a marvelous feeling, and I just like to wish all the people back in New York that didn't make the trip hey, we did it. Your wait is over with.
And go ahead, tell them.
Your wait is over with, and all those 75 years, 100 years, hey, we gonna did it. You got the Super Bowl now here in the New York, New Jersey.
Day, every day.
Are you guys gonna party tonight or what?
Oh, man.
Hey, baby, we gonna go to this little party. We're gonna have some fun.
All the women, I'll send for you.
Yeah, that's right. I'll be there, too. All right, let's go to Steve Parrish. He's outside of the stadium with somebody. Steve, take it away. Thanks.
Thank you, Carl. You know, the one thing about the Rose Bowl and the whole Super Bowl is the excitement in the stands that the fans generate. About 102,000 people all whipped up and all that energy all at once. And it's unlike anything else I've ever been to. It's unlike any kind of a World Series game, because that's spread out over a number of games, or the Stanley Cup. This is all that energy packed into one game, and it explodes in the stands and out on the field. And I'll tell you, the fans that you see are unbelievable. Here's an average one.
Well, hello, New York.
You see what I mean?
Congratulations on a fine victory.
This is a good loser, by the way.
I'm Rocky the Leprechaun, and I'll tell you, to all you folks back in New York, we're proud to play on the field today. And I'll tell you what, here's to you, New York.
He's really from Colorado, and a big ham. But it's been a lot of fun with all of the fans, whether they be on the New York side, whether they be on the Colorado side, the Denver side, it doesn't matter. It's been a blast and a tremendous amount of excitement, John, and I'm sure that you can sense it from there. John?
I certainly can. It looks like everyone's having a good time out there, Steve. I know Bill is and Carl is, and we're going to be going back to Pasadena in a few moments, folks, and we're also going to have a chat with Terry Hanratty when we come back. Stay with us. Special edition of Sports Extra, an hour long tonight, blanket coverage with Bill Mazur and Carl White in Pasadena. In the studio with me right now is Terry Hanratty. And Terry, to me, the story of the game was Phil Simms, a brilliant performance today.
Well, I think, first of all, I got to say that, you know, I wasn't as confident as you and Bill were about the outcome of the game today. Everybody's calling for a blowout, and I have to apologize to all my friends out
Denver.
There. I picked Denver.
Why?
I really thought that Denver could shut down the running, and they did a great job on that. And I didn't think they're going to have all that much success in the past, but you know, today I think everything went together. I thought Denver would have to play a perfect game to beat the Giants, and completely reversed. The Giants played a perfect game today and annihilated Denver.
Let me take you a little further. Are you suggesting, yes, Denver shuts down the running game, Joe Morris did not have an outstanding day, he had 67 yards rushing. Are you suggesting that you believe Phil Simms isn't that good a quarterback, that he wouldn't be able to take the team on the strength of his arm down the field to victory?
No, I think Phil Simms is an outstanding quarterback. I think he's one of the best quarterbacks in the league. But I think the whole time, without Lionel Manuel in the games, you know, with the long injuries he's had, where he's not had that much success with the outside receivers. And Denver has two outstanding cornerbacks. And I thought somehow they'd double cover Bavaro and shut him down a bit. And I thought it was going to be a much lower scoring game, first of all. And I thought it was going to be a lot closer, obviously.
Terry, before we go to Bill Mazur, I have to ask you one question. I know Bill will want to relate to this. First half, Rich Carlos misses two field goals, takes the steam out of his Denver Broncos. Might it have been different if he made those?
I don't think so. I think the obviously, I think there were big misses, but I think the whole key was what the Giants have showed all year, patience.
Patience and a lot of talent. Right now, folks, I know Bill Mazur. Are you out there, Bill, in Pasadena?
Well, he's big, you know.
Oh, there's my man, Phil Sims. Yes, brilliant day. Congratulations, Phil.
Oh, man.
They're talking to you from there. You remember Terry Hanratty, of course, quarterback at Notre Dame who played for Pittsburgh. He was saying that he thought Denver had a chance to shut your running game down, and he thought that might cause a lot of trouble. Will you show him the hand with a bust in here? I just want to show you. We didn't say anything about it.
Is it all right? I got it pretty much healed, yeah.
What do you think?
Oh, well, I don't know.
I mean, your wife looked great. The kid looked great.
There's no reason not to feel her. Yeah. There's no reason not to feel her look great right now. I mean, it just couldn't be any better for me or anybody concerned with the Giants. It's just tremendous. And, you know, I tell you, I'm thrilled to death, believe me.
You know, I'm sitting here looking at you, and I'm thinking, did you ever, really, this is the usual kind, in your wildest dreams, think you'd have a day like today?
Well,
hell, man, you did better than Starr, as well as Bradshaw on the best day. You had a great day.
Yeah, I mean, you're right. I played well. I'm not going to deny that. I played as well as I could hope to play. And you know, I didn't say it all week, but down deep, I just had a feeling that passing the ball was going to be the difference for us. And of course, I would never tell the press that or anybody, but I knew they were going to play us man-to-man. And we talked all week. I told the receivers, we just got to run, and we got to be arrogant, too, and just dare them to cover us. And I tell you, they didn't cover them. Our receivers were fantastic today running from these people.
What about the little dipsy doodle there? I thought you were going to take that ball. Do you remember the play I'm talking about when you threw to McConkey? I figured you'd take off on the sideline and go 90 yards for a touchdown.
Yeah, well.
You ran a little today.
Yeah, oh, well, you know, I run a little almost there. You know, I'm not afraid to come out of that pocket and run the ball. And, you know, when the situation presented itself for me to run the day, I did. And not that I like to, because I tell you, I got a stiff neck from that one hit the guy gave me. But,
yeah, I know. But we thought you were laughing, but it was a grimace, right?
Yes, it was. I told him, I said, that's a hell of a hit. You know, and they all says, yeah, we got to get you out of the game. So,
what'd you think of Elway?
Well, I didn't really pay much attention. Of course, he's a great player. And at the beginning of the game, I did think to myself one time, I said, boy, it's just like they said. He moved around a couple times and hit big plays. But our defense, I figured sooner or later they're going to start putting pressure on him, and I was hoping they'd make some mistakes. They didn't make as many as I thought they really thought they would, but he's a great player, and he played great again today.
You figure they'll boo you in New York ever, or in New Jersey, or anywhere?
Oh, sure they will. I mean, you know, when I play bad, they're going to boo me. I mean, that's the way it goes. When the quarterback's bad, he gets booed, and he's good, they cheer him. So, rightfully so.
When did you become this relaxed about it? I remember 4 years ago, you were ready to throw bombs.
Yeah. You know, I guess I got relaxed about it when I realized there's nothing I can do about it. And, you know, the coaches have helped me a lot in that respect, especially playing, not so much as how I handle things, just playing. They tell me to be reckless. I mean, what a great feeling to be a quarterback and have the coach tell you, just be reckless out there. And it is a good feeling. When I make a mistake, they don't chew me out. They say, it's okay, just keep throwing that thing. And it makes me feel good. And I think that's what turned my year around when they gave me a great vote of confidence and told me they thought I was great, and it made me feel good.
I have to tell you that a couple of years ago, I emceed a luncheon.
Yeah.
He walks in with a busted leg. In a preseason game, Gastineau and Klecko had squashed him between them. And I remember you said, the day will come. And it has, man.
Well,
I mean,
yeah, it's come.
Unbelievable.
Big time. Yeah, it has. It's unbelievable. And, you know, if you stay at something long enough and you work hard enough, you got a chance for it to happen, and it, you know, hard work and wanting it doesn't always get it done. But I happen to be with a great team, and I tell you, and as long as I work and do my part of it, things can go well for me too.
You know, you said something very strange when I saw one of your interviews before. One of the key plays in the game between the Jets and Baltimore in the third Super Bowl, Morrell went back. He had the flea flicker, and he missed everybody.
Yeah.
Now you said you missed a guy. Who
yes.
was it you missed?
It was Bobby Johnson.
He was all alone.
Nobody covered him. I couldn't see down the middle of the field enough.
Why?
Because there was a few people around in front of me, and I just couldn't see good enough. So I knew McConkey was coming across the field. When I saw that nobody was covering him, I quit looking for Bobby, and I just waited for him to go all the way across the field and throw it to him.
Did you get as good protection as you could?
It's probably the best protection I've ever had in a football game this year.
The Suburban line did it for you?
Yes, they did. We might have to quit calling them that. They're getting so good. You know, they played so good, and they play so hard, and they are tough, and that's what makes them a good line.
You know, I appreciate it.
Thank you,
Mike. You've been a friend.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
Let's go back to John Dockery. Thank you, Philly.
Right, thank you. Okay, Bill Mazur, did you realize that Phil Simms, listen to this, folks, an incredible statistical day for the man who was voted most valuable player. 22 of 25, Terry Hanratty, for 268 yards, 3 touchdowns, and 88% completion. I mean, that's a record. It's an incredible performance. When you were listening to Bill with Phil Simms, what struck you the most?
Well, I think just the whole attitude that Phil has. I think it's he shows that the coaching staff has confidence in him. And you can see, I've been in New York about 8 years now, and you can see the confidence he has just in these interviews and the way he performs on the field. When he makes a mistake, he's not letting these things bother him. And that's what I like about him. He's been maligned by everybody in New York, and I think he's finally getting his just due here because it was a great day for him.
Can you play quarterback in the NFL without having that kind of almost arrogance?
Oh, you have to be, because there's, you know, it's been said so many times, but it's so true. When a team is successful, quarterback gets too much credit, and vice versa. And the boos, you can't hear that, and you can't hear the cheering. You just have to go out there. And the main thing is you have to have confidence in your huddle. Once you look at those other 10 guys in the face and you're calling a play, you know, whether it's right or wrong, you got to call it with confidence.
And, you know, New York, the Big Apple right now, is getting ready to celebrate. And our Lynn White, folks, is out in New Jersey at Manny's. Lynn, can you hear me? What is happening out there?
I can't hear you.
You are surrounded.
Question.
Who gets your vote for MVP?
MVP of the game, of course, goes to Jim Burt.
Why are you saying that, I will?
It goes to Jim Burt, Carl Banks, Lawrence Taylor, and Harry Carson, the defensive core for the New York Giants.
What did you think of the game?
Well, I thought that New Jersey Giants contained John Elway, not only John Elway, but they contained the entire offense. They dominated the defense, and they dominated the offense.
What did you think of your cousin's performance?
It was outrageous. Excellent. As usual. Excellent. As usual.
Lynn, can you hear me? No, she can't. How could you hear me surrounded by all those people? Do you notice what Bert said? The New Jersey Bert? He said, the New Jersey Giants.
I caught that.
I know, and the ticker tape parade will not happen. Apparently, the celebration will happen in Giants Stadium on Tuesday. I mean, to me, and Terry, you've been around, I was here in Super Bowl III. We had a ticker tape parade. And to me, not to have a ticker tape parade, which they give to all of the celebrities who do special things like the Mets, like the astronauts, like the Jets way back in 1969, to not have it is almost like winning the Super Bowl and then not getting the ring. I mean, I just can't understand it. Nothing against New Jersey, folks. I just don't understand how you can be the world champions and not be toasted in the Big Apple down Lower Broadway.
Well, things were different in Pittsburgh. Instead of the ticker tape parade, we had a coal parade. Just rode along these old cars and they threw coal at you.
You know, I want to make a point about the game. To me, third quarter, Giants come out, they have the ball. Bill Parcells calls fake punt, fourth down, Rutledge runs for the first down. I mean, what did that tell you about the game? Did you think it was as much of a turning point as I thought it was?
I thought it was a very dumb play on Denver's part. Because if they watch their films, they know who the special teams people are. And Rutledge is not your fullback blocking for your punter on the special teams. And as soon as you see that, you automatically say something's wrong. If anything, call timeout and force them to bring in their punting team. You're telling New York then, we found out you're going to do something strange. You know, get out of it right there. There's no way they should have gone with their regular defense that way.
You know, is that coaching? I mean, is that a coach saying, all right, if you have to take a timeout in a situation where you're confused, you take it? Obviously, they had their punt return team on, and they weren't ready to play defense, and the Giants got the first down. Simms went on to throw a touchdown pass. They went ahead on that drive, so it was a critical point of the game.
Oh, it was. It was a big part, big thing for New York, because they realized the only way, actually, that Denver could have changed is for call a timeout. That way they say, okay, we caught you, then yeah. New York brings in their punting team and kicks it. This way they kept Rutledge in there. They made no adjustments. He came up the line of scrimmage. The guy's never moved. Oh. So there it was.
All right, we got to take a break for a moment because we have to take a commercial. Folks, we'll be right back. Stay with us.
Drink of water. People are always asking you, what was the greatest thing you ever saw? What was the best ball game you ever saw? What was the highlight? I watched that game today, and two people stand out in my mind above all the others. Now remember, the Giants, after all, have a family of stars. There are six All-Pro players. Bill Parcells is not an All-Star. Phil Simms didn't make the team this year. And yet, to me, they were the key to today, and I'll tell you why. Parcells had a very difficult job this week, Terry. His ball club had to be kept up, because everybody was saying they're going to blow him out. Now, you were the Pittsburgh ball club when they were the outstanding team, and I imagine Chuck Knoll did it too. But there was something that weighed on the Giants that must have weighed on that first Pittsburgh team, and that is the feeling in the metropolitan area they're not going to do it. In all the years that I've watched teams in New York, they've always been highly rated, sometimes overrated. The Giants are the first team that was underrated. And it seemed as if everybody was thinking, they're not going to win. It's not going to make it for them. Now you get into a situation where you say to yourself, Parcells has got to get the ball club up, and Simms, who is the most underrated quarterback in football, has to do something. And they both did. And now Carl is with another man who's done a tremendous job, the captain of the Giants, Harry Carson.
That's right. I'm with another guy, and this is another big star for the Giants, Harry Carson, the veteran. Got to feel great about being a world champion.
I really feel great for not so much myself. I really feel happy, you know, about my performance and feeling happy for myself, but I also feel happy for people in the organization, my teammates, the coaches, Wellington Mara, and all of the Giant fans back in the New York metropolitan area.
Would you like to say anything to them? Go ahead, look right in the camera and talk to them. I think
they'd
like to hear from you.
It's been a long time coming, but you guys never gave up on us. And I hope you're all happy now. 23 years of frustration. Throw that sucker out the window, because this is now, we are the world champions.
Thanks a lot, Harry. Okay. Get on the bus, man. Okay. We'll see you at the party.
All right,
take care. Reporting live from the Giants locker room, which is beginning to wind down. Carl White, Channel 5. Sports Extra, whatever this is. Let's go back to New York.
Carl, it is Sports Extra, and it's a night to celebrate here in New York. Terry Hanratty, Phil Mazur mentioned it. Going into a big football game like this, so much hype, a week off, the Giants, the hot team. I mean, they two games going into the playoffs, untouchable against San Francisco and Washington, going in as a big favorite. What kind of problems does that present?
Well, I think it presents, you know, it maybe comparing the Giants to the first Super Bowl team we had in Pittsburgh, is that the Giants are playing in New York. So they are going to get boosted up a little more than the rest of the country. The media is here. And in Pittsburgh, we were sort of the lowly team there. We had rookies that were swan and stalwart at the wide receivers. And Terry Bradshaw wasn't proven at the time to win the big games. And Franco Harris and the Greens and people. And we're playing a veteran team, which was Francis Targin and the Minnesota Vikings. So we were, you know, a slight bit of underdog. There was a closer point spread, I guess. But we had a looseness about us that I've never seen with another team. Swan and Stalwart, they thought they were rookies. That's automatically you play the preseason, regular season, you go to the Super Bowl. You know, everybody sort of just was very loose, and I think it really helps the team, because a lot of teams get tight, especially when you have this two-week period. Believe me, that's, you know, a nonsense period to have, but you have to play that.
The hype is incredible. My feeling is a loose team wins the Super Bowl. Remember a few years back, the Raiders are loose, the San Francisco 49ers are loose, Big Bill Walsh dressing up as a doorman at the door, keeping his team loose. Philadelphia Eagles were as tight as a drum. They got buried in the Super Bowl. So I think you're right. The loose team does win the Super Bowl. Folks, we're not finished on this special edition of Sports Extra. Hope you'll stay with us. Bill Mazur is out in California. So is Carl White. Terry Hanratty here with me in the studio. We'll be right back. ...has been made of the Giants' defense, and admittedly, they are an outstanding defense. You and I were in Pittsburgh together. The Steel Curtain, to me, may have been the best defense of all time. What's your thoughts?
Well, I'm a little prejudiced, John. I think it was. I think when you look back, what we did with four people, most of the people in the NFL do with seven now. We had the Joe Greens, the Elster Greenwoods. We never blitzed back then. We didn't have to, because they stopped the run. You know, we held Minnesota 21 yards rushing. We held Oakland in the playoff game to like 58 yards rushing. And these guys did everything. They shut down Stabler and targeting in the passing. And we got to drop everybody back. If I had to make a comparison, I think Pittsburgh had the better defensive line. By far, I think the linebackers with the Giants are better. I think we had a better secondary.
I know, it's incredible. We have some video on Carl Banks. I mean, the emergence of Carl Banks, as you take a look at him right here, watch him cut through to make that tackle, doesn't allow people to neutralize Lawrence Taylor, because if they run away from Lawrence Taylor, who do they meet? Number 58 right here. And he had an incredible game today, and he just grew as the season went on. And to me, you talk about the linebackers on the Giants, and they are as good as any set that I've ever seen. Yeah, the Pittsburgh Steelers had Jack Hammond, Andy Russell, and Lambert.
Different kind of linebackers, though.
Different kind of linebackers.
They weren't the brute strength with the speed that the Giants have. I've never seen guys like this before. They're 6'5", 245. They're defensive ends playing at linebackers with much more speed than... You know, we had Jack Ham, who I think is going to be a Hall of Famer one of these days.
No doubt.
That he was a finesse player. He's not going to come up and really intimidate you. Lambert is a different story. He's a Looney Tune. But, you know, he would just knock everybody's head off. And, you know, so, and he played the pass extremely well. I think probably he's one of the top three or four all-time middle linebackers against everything. He was a little weaker against the run, but extremely good against the pass.
You know, Terry, my colleagues, Bill Mazur and Carl White, are waiting out in Pasadena right now. And gentlemen, are you there?
John, we are not only here, but we hear you and Terry talking about those halcyon days of yore.
Bill, if you gentlemen, keep it up, you know what gentlemen, I'm going to start talking about. Super Bowl III, underdogs, and all that stuff.
No. All hail to the Giants. And I got to tell you something else. How about the rookie kid over here? The rookie joined us this year just in time to become part of the Mets win. And then joined us just in time to become part of the Giants.
What did I say before this game started?
You said the rookies? Yeah, when we sat with one of them.
I said, I'm the luckiest guy in the world, Bill, and I'm not kidding you. I got to New York just in time to cover the Mets, to work with you, and now the Giants in the Super Bowl. It's been fantastic.
What was it like in the locker room?
The locker room was kind of subdued. I thought there'd be champagne and everything all over the place.
Well, you got ready for the champagne.
Yeah,
you
had
put on your champagne clothes.
This is the same coat the Mets wanted in. But there was no champagne flowing, but the guys were still very much... happy on the inside. I think they were kind of still subdued. Maybe it'll sink in tomorrow. They keep saying it hasn't sunk in. It'll sink in sooner or later.
Tell them what happened during the first half when I told you I had picked the Giants 35-3.
Right.
Coming to the close of the first half, I said to Carl, I may jump off the roof of the building.
It was unbelievable because Denver was controlling the game so well in the first half.
But then what changed it?
Well, it was just a matter of the linebackers becoming active. You know,
what did we say?
We said that the Giants had to... what did we say? I can't remember.
We said they had to take command. And remember
Oh, that's right.
Buddy Ryan told me they're going to kick
some
butt. But he didn't say
butt. It was
butt,
a better word.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know what? I have to ask you gentlemen something,
well,
Bill.
We said the Giants have to make a statement defensively.
Yeah. Bill.
I'm listening to you, Dockery.
As the lights go out, there was some talk at halftime on CBS that the Giants may have been wilting somewhat in the heat out in Pasadena. Who said that?
Yeah.
Irv Cross on CBS made the comment. They went into the locker room. They looked a little flat. They were trailing 10-9, after all, against a team they were supposed to bury and blow away. And he said that they looked slightly deflated, and maybe the heat had something to do with that.
John, I'm not putting you on. Who said it for CBS? No, seriously.
Irv Cross was by the locker room when the Giants came out of the locker room and made the suggestion that maybe the heat was taking its toll on some of the older Giant players. Certainly, it didn't bear true in the second half.
Hey, John, one of the older Giant players, George Martin, made one of the key plays. He's the highest scoring lineman against Denver this year. He's had 8 points.
That's right.
As far as Marshall is concerned, he's in good shape. Bird is in good shape. The only thing about Bird, you know, he's got the bad back, and he's very well aware it could be the end of football for him if the ruptured disc doesn't come through. But those linebackers, I mean, hey, the only, I swear, did I tell you in the middle of the week that they never try to go to the outside, they try to come up the middle because of Banks and of Taylor?
Let me tell you something. I couldn't hear John, but I get the feeling you guys are talking about players retiring or the Giants getting old.
Yeah.
The only guy that was talking in there about retirement was Andy Hedden, but he was just kidding. I mean, he was going up and down, that's it, I'm finished. I want to finish on top of the game. I'm going to retire after this game. But it was all just a big joke. Hedden was going to be around next year.
Let me ask you
a guys
question.
Go ahead.
Were the Giants as confident all week long as they appeared to be when they came onto the field? Excited, enthusiastic, confident.
All right. John asked me whether the Giants were as confident as they appeared to be when they came out on the field. I was trying to say this beforehand about Parcells. I think that's the one thing Parcells did that was important. Yes, I think at the beginning of the week, the Giants felt,
we're going to knock heads. And I think Parcells got him out on the field and said, listen, you better get down to cases or you'll be dead. And that's Parcells' greatest asset. John, I got to tell you, the Giants are very respectful of Bill Belichick. They think he's terrific, but he's only 34 years old, and so he's got to be a little tougher with them because some of them are his age. But they love Parcells, and the more he whips them, the more they love him.
That's right.
You know, and he got them into that mood. And when Colleen, Jim Burt's wife, said to me, Jimmy was so nervous this morning, I said, good. Now you know they're up for the game. I think they're a great football team. I think they're the most underrated team, period, that I've ever seen in New York. And listen, you know what they're doing out here, John? The helicopters are flying over yelling, get off the air.
Bill,
what else did you want to talk about?
Bill,
you want to ask Carl something?
I want to come back in a moment and talk to you, so please don't leave. I know the lights are flickering, but we have a couple of other things I'd like to talk to you about. But right now, we have to take a break for a moment. Right back.
All right.
Against the Denver Broncos, 105-23. An incredible defensive effort. And, of course, the offense came alive, Terry. Middle of the year, they had their problems. Remember Phil Sims and the offense had some problems. What do you think turned it around? Was it Phil Sims, the vote of confidence given by the coaching staff? Can that do it for a quarterback?
See, an offense can be slow when you have the defense that the Giants have, because they're always going to get you ball in pretty good field position. And they're going to shut down teams. You don't have to score a lot of points, which they won a lot of games with very low scores. Until what really killed the Giants in the middle of the season offensively was the injury to Lionel Manuel early in the year. And the Giants weren't getting, you know, I'd watch it on television, watch some of these pass routes. They weren't giving Phil Sims good throwing lanes for a quarterback. And all of a sudden everybody said, well, Sims has tunnel vision. He's just throwing down the middle to Barbaro. But once a quarterback doesn't have the confidence in the outside people, he's going to narrow himself down that way. It's only human nature. Once you give, you know, the Giants could be really scary with a couple outstanding wide receivers.
And the emergence of the offensive line, I mean, they were underrated. No one talked much about them. Brad Benson came on to be a Pro Bowl left tackle for them, played brilliantly against some outstanding defensive ends. To me, the offensive line grew, and a lot of people don't know that. To me, they were bigger, faster, stronger, and much more physical team on both sides of the ball than the Denver Broncos. That doesn't happen by accident. Johnny Parker, their outstanding fitness coach, is a guy who studies in Russia the latest techniques and works them year-round. I mean, I was over there in the off-season. Phil Sims was running quarter miles and lifting weights, you know, in March and April underneath the stadium. So I think that kind of physical, you know, it just came out in the second half.
The one thing you'll see, though, is Phil Sims stays in the pocket, and he throws from there. And I think, you know, everyone that talks about the mobility of a John Elway getting out of sight and running and throwing a ball, I think in net result, it hurts Denver. Because your offensive line, you know, they form this cup. They don't know where the quarterback's going to be. So it discourages them to, you know, give good protection. Where Sims stays in that pocket, these guys know if they have a breakdown, their quarterback's going to get sacked. They know exactly where the quarterback's going to be all the time. Elway has great mobility. You know, you look back to Bradshaw in the early days, where the offensive line had no idea where he was. Strongest, fastest quarterback you'd ever want to see. He's running all over the place. We weren't
successful.
An Elway
type of quarterback, yeah.
Exactly. We were not successful until Terry stayed in that pocket and threw the ball from there. You got to start your passing game from a pocket pass and teach these offensive linemen how to pass protect. You saw today, Sims had all day long to throw the ball. He's going to complete them.
Bill Mazur, are you there? Do you
I'm
think
here, you know,
that... Bill, can you hear me? Do you think that the Giants dodged the bullet a little bit when Rich Carlos missed two field goals in the first half? What was the feeling in the stadium as the Giants go in at halftime down 10-9, potentially down 16-9?
John is asking, what was the feeling in the stadium, you know, when Carlos missed the two? I don't know what they felt because I wasn't with them, but what did I tell you?
Well, you just said that was the turning point of the game.
They got their best shot.
That's right. That
they're only behind 10-9, the Giants are, when Denver could have been up by more than that. But Hanratty, Terry, you hit on a major point when you were saying about staying in the pocket. I don't think you guys saw it, but Bill Parcells, giving an interview to the press here, said he told his defensive team, you chase Elway's butt all over the field. He's going to get tired before you guys do. And when the second half began, he said, don't do anything different. I don't care where he goes. Chase him. Wear on him.
Bill, the
good imitation.
Bill,
very good imitation.
Bill, they maybe it was destiny. Carlos misses a couple of field goals. The play, the controversial play to Clarence Kay that he doesn't catch, and then the safety right afterwards. It was over when that those kinds of things started to happen.
You know, John, truly, I love this place. This is Hollywood. The hills out there are gorgeous.
Say goodbye.
But you got to know, where we sat, forget it. Nosebleed. It was a rumor. So,
it wasn't that bad, Bill. Come on.
I bleed easier than you do.
Bill.
Good night, folks.
Bill.
Good night, everybody.
Thank you very much, Bill Mazur,
okay.
Carl White, Steve Powers,
County.
Lynn White, and my guest, Terry Hanratty. Thanks for joining us. Folks, we're glad that you could be with us for this special edition of Sports Extra. Yes, the Giants are Super Bowl champions. They beat the Denver Broncos 39-20 today out in Pasadena. Let's all celebrate. What do you say? Good night, everybody.